I start by asking you to just give your reaction to the news we outlined.
Well, Ed, I'm amazed. It's 11 years from a fundamental discovery in science to an approved therapeutic. That's just extraordinary speed, and it speaks to the many, many people that contributed to make that possible.
I posted on X the news, and what I was surprised by is the number of people who responded saying that they had been impacted by sickle cell disease, either a family member, somebody they know. Could you just explain the basics of what this treatment would do, how it would work?
Well, sickle cell disease is a human condition that results from a single gene in our DNA that is defective. And in patients that have two copies of that gene, they have terrible symptoms, pain, crises they go through. It shortens their lifespan. It's really a devastating disorder. And what CRISPR offers now is, for some patients at least, an opportunity to have a treatment that is effectively a cure. They don't, they get a one and done therapy that removes their symptoms for the rest of their life.
I'm interested in now the application, Jennifer, and ultimately how quickly you think this can be in the hands of patients and really from an economic perspective, an inequality perspective in the hands of patients when it's likely to be pretty expensive.
Right. Well, you bring up a very important point, and that's a reason that we're working hard at the Innovative Genomics Institute at the University of California to ensure that this type of therapy becomes widely available and affordable. Because as you point out, it's an expensive treatment right now. It also involves weeks of hospitalization to deliver the therapy. So we really want to figure out ways to have new technologies intersecting with genome editing that will reduce costs and make it more available to people worldwide.
And talking of worldwide, the UK, the regulators there had signed off the use of CRISPR-Cas9. How do you think this will become a global story? How do you think that it will evolve to help other diseases that currently affect and are passed down the generations?
Well, here's a very exciting thing about CRISPR, and that is that it's a therapeutic that can be programmed for different diseases. And now that we see the path forward with sickle cell disease, which is amazing, first start, it's really the beginning of what I think will be a new era of medicine, where we have in the future cures for various kinds of genetic disorders and perhaps even one day preventive treatments that result from modifying our genes.
The supply chain for these treatments is complicated, Jennifer. We've covered on the show the idea that you do a lot of the R&D and prelim manufacturing planning while it's pre-approval. Do you have confidence that there will be a sort of availability of treatments for those that need them based on the market's ability to make them, to provide them?
Well, I do. I think it won't happen overnight, but there's enormous effort going on both in nonprofits and, of course, in many companies to ensure that there will be supply chain benefits from this, that we'll be able to figure out how to get these products made and the quantities that are needed. And I think that over time, and it will take some time, there are going to be some streamlining processes that will just advance the therapies and make it more and more available to people around the world.
We outlined your 2020 Nobel Prize Award, the work that you've done. Is there work, at least at the intersection of academia and biotechnology, that still needs to be done in this field? And if so, what are you doing right now?
Yes. As I was driving to work this morning, I was thinking, you know, this is a wonderful, exciting day, but it's also the very beginning, and there's a lot of work to be done. It's time to roll up our sleeves. I think we need to really work hard to figure out how to, as we discussed, make these therapies more widely available, of course, bring down the cost. And I think that will be a combination of technical developments as well as working with regulators, working with patient advocacy groups, and really figuring out how we appropriately partner between academics and companies to control the cost in a way that will, you know, make this benefit available to many.
And you do that. You are that sort of go-between between academia and helping advise companies. And I look at CRISPR, which the company involved here that has what, about $5 billion market capitalization. Vertex is a $90 billion market capitalization, can put in the R&D spend. But what about the money allocated to this field of work at the moment, Jennifer? And where is the money necessary to come from?
Well, it comes from various sources. Of course, investors are playing a big role in these companies, but we're also seeing big input from the governments. So you may know the National Institutes of Health in the U.S. has a major effort to advance gene editing in the context of gene and cell therapy. So that's very important. We have other nonprofit organizations that do philanthropic support of science. The Gates Foundation comes to mind, but there are many others who are supporting this. So there's a lot of effort here. And I think many people appreciate the potential of genome editing to impact large numbers of people if we can really figure out how to reduce costs and make these widely available therapies available to people around the world.
Of course, back in 2020, the world was in a very different place, and the joy and necessary optimism around leaps and bounds of creativity and technological development in science, in particular medicine, was really important. It feels that 2023, all the oxygen has been dragged out of the room when it comes to AI innovation and generative AI. To that end, there's a lot of discussion about safety. And I know that's a big point for you, Jennifer. How are you thinking about the application of CRISPR technologies and ensuring that this is rolled out in the safest way manner possible?
Well, it's a great question. It's very important. This is one of our founding principles at our institute, is ensuring safety and responsibility as CRISPR technologies continue to advance. I think it's, for me, one of the questions regarding ethics is really about equity. And we've touched on that a lot in this conversation. It's very important. But I also think we have to continue to think about safety and effectiveness of these therapies, and to figure out really how to work with regulators to ensure that we have a process for testing the safety, but also that we advance the therapies as quickly as we can to help patients. It's a delicate balance.
But Jennifer, I want to return to the idea that if sickle cell is the start, what is the next step? What is the next breakthrough that could help humankind?
Well, I'm very excited about a couple of things. I think that certainly advancing the genome editing approach into other types of tissues will be important. And we're seeing some great progress there in terms of, especially for liver disease, work being done by a company called Intellia that, for disclosure, I'm a founder of, although I didn't do any of the science they're doing. And they've shown effectiveness in treating rare liver diseases using CRISPR genome editing. And the important thing there is they're delivering these molecules directly into patients without requiring a bone marrow transplant, which is required for the sickle cell treatment. So I think that's an exciting advance. And then there's also work to, in the future, provide protective medicine for people who have genes that might make them susceptible to cardiovascular disease, for example. So that's work coming out of a company called Verve. So I would keep an eye on those. I think they're really exciting developments in the field going forward.